Stood up to read, but he sat down to teach. So even this setting is biblical. Let's begin with prayer. Our Father in heaven, we commit this precious time together to you as we want to see Jesus. And not just see him, but to know him, to step out in obedience and learn how he is to be totally trusted. That's what we want, to dare to step out, to grow in that personal relationship to him, our precious Savior. So we ask your blessing on each one of us here, and on those who may have opportunity to watch this teaching on video. Lord, that your hand of blessing might be on each one. We ask also your blessing on Ken and Rosemary Acton as they are videoing this teaching. Lord, that this technology may be under your control and at your service. Oh Lord, we thank and praise you for what you've done for us, and we just want to get to know more about you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom from Jerusalem. And welcome to Halford House in Richmond on the Thames, here at the edge of London. As we are about to begin a course, an introduction to the Bible study method of the Jerusalem School of Synoptic Research, the Jerusalem School of Synoptic Gospel Studies, as we call ourselves, a group of Christian and Jewish scholars cooperating in Jerusalem. And as a Christian member of that school of thought, it's not a building or a structure, I want to see Jesus. I hope that for us together this course is going to be a window to Jesus. And we have four windows in the New Testament, four Gospels. We're going to be concentrating on three of them, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Now, the course has some system to it, with this first 2 hours spent in introduction. But then, a first main point will be an introduction to the Jerusalem School in terms of how it got started, who are the men involved, who are the personages, the men and the women involved. And then, what kind of a theory of the relationship between Matthew, Mark, and Luke has developed through these studies in Jerusalem. Then a second main point would be kind of the background of synoptic gospel theories. What throughout church history have Christians thought about the relationship between the gospels? And so we'll be putting this old new theory out of Jerusalem in the context of what's being taught at the seminaries. And what are the stakes that are involved? What difference does it make? What do you think about the relationship between the gospel writers? And then finally, application, we might call it, putting this study method to use on texts. So the Jerusalem School, the historical background of other synoptic theories, and then finally putting our method into practice. But it's not going to be that rigid. What we're going to do is here and there suddenly jump to a text and check out whether a point that's being made can be illustrated out of the text. We'll, even now this evening already, be doing something rather inductive of looking at a text and just seeing what's there. What are the facts of what's in front of us? Looking very carefully at that and then asking ourselves questions. What do we learn from these similarities and differences between the different gospel writers? And I should warn you, as we begin now with some definitions, that we're entering the jungle. You know, if you go to a jungle, you have to learn the language of the people of the jungle. And in that respect, the scholarly world is no different. You have to learn some of the vocabulary and the language of the scholars if you want to serve scholars. And different ones of us have different callings. Some of us have been called into this scholarly jungle, and we've had to learn the language of this particular jungle. So we'll begin with just this word, synoptic. The optic part is clear enough, seeing. The S-Y-N from a Greek word for together. Seeing together. And it's a word that describes the first three Gospels, which have more similarity to each other. They're like seeing things more from a similar angle than John with his more philosophical, theological, high-flown perspective over the whole picture of Jesus from creation is where he starts before he gets down to actually reporting what Jesus said and did. So the synoptic Gospels. Then we speak of a synoptic problem. The problem being the peculiar combination, as you read these three Gospels, of similarities and differences. And we're going to be taking very hard, close look at both the similarities and the differences. And here, your heartstrings already start twanging, depending on where you're coming from philosophically. What's your perspective on life? If you're someone who knows in advance that there is no such thing as the supernatural, well, the differences are your delight. I mean, you just plow into these texts and say, ha-ha, you know, look at all these differences between this version and that version. Fireside tales, legends out of the past, and with a few nice moral, ethical teachings and points to be learned. But if you know in advance that there's no such thing as a supernatural, of course, I know there's many people in the scholarly world who have exactly that orientation. They don't even hardly take a second look at the birth narratives. You know, in Luke of the shepherds and in Matthew of the magi and the wise men and the star in the sky. And they kind of breeze past that and try to find, you know, a few ethical teachings here and there. On the other hand, for those of us who relate to the Bible as the Word of God, we're expecting similarities because here are different testimonies to the one and same Lord Jesus. And so we find our delight in the similarities that here, in spite of their different personalities, they're able to get together and give such a unified testimony to the Lord Jesus. But you see, if you come from the two different angles, your joy is going to be either in the similarities or in the differences. And your problem is going to be, what do you do with the opposite? Because for those who are enjoying the differences, they've got a problem. There are incredible similarities between these writers. So incredible that it's rather difficult to imagine that four different men could hit on that kind of agreement. So how did they do it? Each one separately, by direct inspiration of the Holy Spirit? Did one copy from the other, and that's how they were able to get such identities and similarities? These are the kind of questions that we'll be asking as we look at the problem, this peculiar relationship between incredible similarities, but very peculiar and unusual differences as well, as we read the Synoptic Gospels, and our premises are going to be what control. I just had a couple-hour conversation with Professor Antilato of Turku in Finland, who has the unusual, perhaps he is the single New Testament scholar who has a degree in mathematics and in mathematical logic. And he said it's incredible in New Testament scholarship how much shoddy logic is used in arguments and how much the premise of a New Testament scholar is really all that he's doing is elaborating it. And so he should at least be honest and upfront. I remember criticizing one of my fellow Lutheran students for studying Catholic theology for his doctor's degree at Yale University, where we were both studying. And he gave me quite a retort. He said, "Well, at least the Catholic professors around here still believe in Jesus as their professor, which is more than I can say for our Protestant professors." And there were Protestant professors who did believe in the supernatural and who did believe in God and who did believe that Jesus is the fullest revelation of God the Creator. But there were others who didn't believe in Jesus, who scarcely believed in God. And so the premises of one scholar who barely believes in God as over against another who thoroughly believes in Jesus as God's revelation are going to affect how they approach the texts. And so one should be honest in advance. And so our approach is going to be one of believing in the supernatural, believing in God, believing that he has supernaturally come to be among us as Emmanuel, with us, God, as Emmanuel, as Jesus, the Son of God. And we're going to have a chance to see the impact of these different premises on how one makes interpretations, whether there's a kind of a joy and a gladness as we see the Scriptures as God has allowed them to be, as over against folks who might come with not Jesus as their primary premise, but some doctrine as their primary premise, and they get disturbed by what they read. Or from the other side, some skeptic who is confronted with such amazing similarities that he'll get disturbed by what he reads. Let's begin then by just looking at the titles of the Gospels and turn to our English edition of the synopsis. The synopsis being a book that presents all three. It can be in parallel columns, such as in our Throckmorton synopsis. There are such a thing as horizontal line synopsis, where you'd have Matthew in one line across the top, and then Mark in the next line across the top, and Luke in the next line, so that you could look down from one sentence to the other and see how carefully the words parallel each other or don't parallel each other. And for a sentence-level study, that's the most helpful kind of synopsis. But of course, you don't get very much of an overview, you know, when you have sets of three sentences, several sets across, you know, down the page, as over against what we have with the parallel columns. And this particular synopsis actually goes back to 1892, when a German professor Hock, as is mentioned in our preface, put together a Greek synopsis of the Greek gospel texts in parallel columns, vertically. Now, he's not the first. In 1776 already, there was Jacob Griesbach, who did the same for the first time with the parallel columns of the gospel texts printed out vertically so that you could see together. And he, I understand, is the first one to invent this term, synopse, you know, auf Deutsch in German, synopsis in English, seeing the texts together where they're side by side. And let's take a look here at the beginning of Matthew. And here, on page 1 of our synopsis, it says, an account, Matthew 1, verse 1, an account of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David. And then it jumps to Abraham and gives us the genealogy. Now here in English it says, an account. The Greek word that's used is one that you'll all recognize, biblos, a book. The book of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah. So it's not called a gospel at all. It's called a book of the genealogy of the heritage of the Messiah. And when one reads Matthew, you find that he'll emphasize, you know, this happened so that, you know, such and such a scripture could be fulfilled. And he starts out right off the bat establishing that Jesus is from this long line that goes way back to Abraham. An account of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, or a book. Then let's turn to the beginning of Luke's Gospel on page 4. And he's got one whopping, long, complicated sentence. Since many have undertaken to set down an orderly account of the events that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed on to us by those who from the very beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, I too decided, after investigating everything carefully from the first, to write an orderly account, to write in sequence for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the truth concerning the things about which you have been instructed. He's already been instructed in these things, but now Luke wants to write an orderly account. Now here's inspired text indicating that there are many accounts out there before Luke wrote at all. And the question is, what's his relationship to those accounts? And, you know, do we have them? Or if we don't, you know, can we conjecture about them? Many have undertaken to set down an orderly account of the events that have been fulfilled among us. So what's he writing about? He's writing about the events. And you know, the second book of Luke is the Acts of the Apostles, the events in the lives of the apostles. And so really, this is not called a gospel here at the beginning. If we look at the wording of the text, and of course even the name Luke is one that's not in the book. I mean, it's a church tradition that Luke wrote this what? An account of the events. So it's the Acts of Jesus. If we just take the title out of the book itself, the first book is the Acts of those things that have been fulfilled, and we know that it's about Jesus, the Acts of Jesus, and the second book is the Acts of the Apostles. So he's not calling what he's about to do a gospel. He's going to write about the events so that you may know the truth. Well, what's the problem? I mean, he's been instructed in these things before. Are there some different accounts or some spurious accounts? Or the writer has got a concern to put this down in order so that Theophilus will know the truth. The Acts of Jesus written so that a believer who's already been instructed in these things will know more accurately, more in order about the Acts of Jesus. And then we'll turn on to the beginning of Mark on page 11. Mark 1:1. And here we finally have it. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The beginning of the Evangelion, the beginning of the good message, the gospel of Jesus the Messiah, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So we're already getting a sense that God is allowing different personalities to work at writing up the witness to Jesus. Matthew is writing a book that wants to emphasize the genealogy and the heritage of Jesus. And Luke is writing an account of the acts of Jesus. And Mark spells it right out at the beginning. I want to tell you about the good news of Jesus the Messiah. And in church history, we've picked this last name as the one to describe all three and the fourth book of John. So here we've had a first little introduction to different slants that each one is coming with. In fact, John starts out, "In the beginning was the Word." He goes way back to creation. "And the Word was with God, and the Word was God," the divinity, the life, the light. And then finally he says what he's about in about verse 14 of John 1:14, "The Word became incarnate." That's what John is writing about, this magnificent creative Word that has become flesh and dwelt among us. And there's John's slant. Let's turn to John, or I will, since you perhaps just have your synopsis with you. John chapter 12 and verse 20. Because actually, there's only one gospel. There's not four gospels. There's one gospel, and it's about Jesus, the good news about Jesus. And so the titles that have been handed down in the church are the gospel according to. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And so that's really what we're after. Never mind the different slants, you know, of the different four different writers. We're after the one gospel. We're after the good news about Jesus. And let's read here in John 12, verse 20. "Now among those who went up to worship at the feast were some Greeks. And they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and they said to him, 'Sir, we wish to see Jesus.'" Well, that's what this whole course is about. One gospel, one Lord, Jesus the Messiah. "We wish to see Jesus." Now, they surely got an answer that they didn't bargain on getting. They asked a Greek question, and they got a Jewish answer, a very Jewish answer. Just listen to what Jesus says. "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Well, he hits them with a term that they don't even know. And we'll look at later what Son of Man means in the Scriptures and in the Jewish background. You know, we speak of Son of God and we mean His divinity and Son of Man and we mean His humanity. And we're going to find out that in Jewish background, Son of Man is about as divine a title as you can get, more so than Messiah. A title that Jesus uses about Himself more than any other. And here, when He says, "We want to see Jesus," first thing He talks about is Son of Man. You know, this one who sits at the right hand of the Ancient of Days and is coming with power and glory on the clouds at the end of time to judge the quick and the dead. So they probably didn't even understand, you know, what He's talking about when they said, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Then it gets, if anything, more difficult. "Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies," I mean, if you're excited about a Bible teacher or some, you know, you're not expecting the second thing he talks about is dying. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. He who loves his life loses it. He who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. See, here we are sitting in a classroom situation, and I'm going to be handing out information, you know, sharing information. Sometimes I tell my students, if you don't pray for me, you get exactly what you deserve, dry information. If you pray, who knows, you know, what may come of our interaction. But that's not really what it's about. That's just scarcely a starter. I mean, this Jewish answer that Jesus is giving some Jews who might, some Greeks who may tend to have this more, we want to see Jesus, we want to, you know, see him, yes, physically, we want to understand what he's about. And what's the answer? Follow me. Because of knowledge not just being a matter of intellectual insight, knowledge being a matter of relationship to God, of having this personal relationship of seeing Jesus, yes, and hearing what he has to say, but then seeing and hearing in a very different way, which is following him. And so there's going to be very little of this real learning going on in this classroom situation where we're sharing intellectually. It's going to depend on how much prayer goes up as to what happens when you go out of the classroom and you take some little or big insight that you have about who Jesus is and what he wants you to do, and then comes the crunch, you know, do I do it? Do I dare to step out and check this person out and try out what he's suggesting and act on it and then see if it works? I sound like an American now, don't I? Pragmatic. Stepping out to check it out. But that's what Jesus says. Taste and see that I'm good. And so there's very little learning that's going on here except as maybe a catalyst to having an insight, well, let me check that out. Let me try that out. Let me try to follow Jesus in this way. And that's where you start growing. And this is a kind of growth that happens. Doesn't matter how old you are. Doesn't matter how learned you are. You know, in the academic jungle, it's just like the business jungle. Somebody works hard for many years and he earns a lot of money and he knows that he really put in a lot of effort. And so, you know, he's got a lot of money. He's a little bit above somebody who hasn't worked quite that hard and hasn't got that much money. And it's exactly the same in the academic world. You study and study for years and years and memorize and repeat and turn it over and over again until you've got a lot of facts. And you've got the same problem as a man who's rich with money. You're rich with facts. And you worked hard. And it's so easy for it to go to your head, and then you lord it over somebody who doesn't have quite as many facts. Oh, you didn't read such and such a book, or, you know, all this one-upmanship that goes on. You know, if the Lord says it's hard for a rich man to be saved, you know, it must be at least as hard for a professor to be saved. Unless we get this straight, that seeing Jesus involves dying, you know, giving up on some of the things that we thought were good things to do, but we learned from Jesus they're not, and we're ready to give them up for something much more important, something much more worthwhile. We dare to step out and trust that something that looks hard and involves self-denial is going to be so much more rewarding that we're ready to try it. We're ready to follow him. So as we continue now in this introduction, three windows on one gospel, on one Jesus. Let's just take a look at his Jewish name. Jesus Christ, Emmanuel. Yeshua is his name in Hebrew. And just think about it. When the angel told what his name was supposed to be, you will call his name Yeshua because he will, Yoshia, he will save. And the noun for salvation is Yeshua. So you get quite a dose just in his name already when you start digging into the backgrounds and roots of where Jesus is coming from, into his language, into his culture. If you put the accent in the middle, it's a masculine name, Yeshua. If you put the accent on the end, Yeshua, it's a feminine noun. It's the word for salvation. And then Christ, Christos in Greek, Mashiach in Hebrew. Now, in Hebrew, it's Mashiach, and the Greeks translated it. Christos means anointed. Now, we didn't translate it into English. We transliterated the Greek word, and so we got a new word in English, Christ. So we have to dig a little bit to get from Christ in English to Christos in Greek, which is a translation of Mashiach, which means anointed. So his name, Jesus Christ, salvation, anointed. And what's anointing all about? When you read Jesus' Bible, as I love to call it, the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, whenever he says scriptures, that's what he's talking about. Anointing is anointing kings because they're chosen by God for a task, anointing priests. It's a ceremony of expressing God's choice, God's appointing of this one who is being anointed. So the name, Jesus Christ, salvation, anointed, with the understanding that it's God's chosen salvation, his name, in a paraphrastic translation, would be God's way. Jesus Christ is God's way of doing things. He's the way he wants us to follow. Remember the early name for the followers of Jesus were followers of the way. And he even said that once about himself. At least once, I am the way. He is God's way. This is what life is all about. To live the way Jesus lived. I mean, it wasn't enough for God to tell us in the Torah, in the instructions, the guidance, the teaching. Sometimes all too often we translate it law, which is too small a word. He came and lived it out among us in Yeshua HaMashiach, in Jesus Christ, in God's way of doing things, so that we even have him as an example. And if we want to know him, we have to follow him. That's the only way to know Jesus. You can know about him, but you can't know him without following him. In Luke chapter 8, you have the parable of the sower. And those dumb disciples didn't even understand it. Remember that? Jesus tells parables. He's trying to make a point easy. You know, he's trying to illustrate a point. He's trying to tell about the different kinds of soil and the seed that falls on these different kinds of soil and the different things that happen to the seed, that the birds snatch it, or it starts growing, gets choked by thorns, or it grows in such shallow soil that it withers, or finally there's the good soil. And they didn't get the point. And afterwards, they come up to Jesus and they ask him, well, now what did you mean by that parable? And he explains it to them, but not right away. First he says, and that's in Luke 8, chapter 10, to you it's given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God. To you it's given to know the secrets, the mysteries of the... Well, these dumb disciples who can't even understand an illustration, what mysteries do they know about how God is ruling in the world? Well, where it really counted, they weren't dumb at all. They understood that if you don't understand something, you go to Jesus. They knew the mystery. They knew the secret. God is ruling in Jesus. That's this deep mystery. That's the secret of where God is at most fully. So stick close to Him. Over and over again, you'll find the bright boys, you know, some of the scribes. Jesus tells an illustration, and they get the point immediately. They're right there. They're right with Him. They understand what He's talking about. They know where He's quoting from in Scriptures. They understand Him, and they don't like it. And they don't accept it. And here are these dumb disciples. You know, I'd much rather be a dumb bunny disciple like this than a bright boy. And we're going to be looking into some of the bright boy things as we look into our texts. But here's the secret of successful Bible study. Not the information that's being exchanged, but what you do with it when you go out. If you're like the disciples who knew the mystery, who knew this, stay close to Jesus. If you don't understand something, keep pestering Him about it. You know, keep asking Him. Sometimes you get immediate answers, and sometimes it takes years. I mean, He's the Lord, and He knows the time that you need in your emotional growth, you know, where you're at spiritually. But that's the real method of Bible study, is stay close to Jesus, ask Him your questions, and what you do understand, here's the thing, sometimes He won't answer a question because there are things that you do understand and you're not doing it, you're not following Him. So you have to get to work obeying what you do understand, and then you grow in your deep personal knowledge of Him. And so I'll conclude this section of three windows, one gospel, you know, one Lord Jesus, and what it really means to see Him, to know Him, by something that an Orthodox Jewish friend of mine shared with me. He was quite excited when he came in Jerusalem to our home for Bible translators. I may mention that later. We're bringing Bible translators from around the world so that they can see the land of the Bible, so they can learn the language of the Bible and then translate more accurately back into their own mother tongues. Well, he was there at a reception at the home for Bible translators. And he said, you know that Parashat HaShavua, the reading of the week in the synagogue, had a beautiful insight. And it was from Deuteronomy 11, verse 18. And this is going to be the last point now in this very Jewish answer that Jesus gave. Follow me. Not just look at me. Follow me. 11:18 in Deuteronomy. You shall therefore lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul, and you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes, and you shall teach them to your children, talking of them when you are sitting in your house, and when you are walking by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise, and you shall write them on the doorposts of your house. And it just says, you. And you don't know, reading in English, if it's singular or plural. And so why did this friend bring up this verse? He said, you know, translation and how you translate is important. And I'll bet this is something that your English translations have missed. And so we turn to several different ones. This one is the Revised Standard Version, and it has you. And then we turn to the King James. And King James says this, therefore shall ye lay up these words, my words in your heart, and ye shall teach them to your children, speaking of them, when thou sittest in thy house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. And there's a shift from plural to singular. And he said, our rabbi gave such a beautiful teaching on this shift from plural to singular. He said, look at this. Ye shall teach them. You see, how are you going to get spirituality across from one generation to another? How are you going to teach your children? Ye, plural, shall teach them to your children, speaking of them, of these things, of my words, when thou sittest in thy house. He said, now teaching is something you can do in a classroom. You can do in the plural. You can share with a number at one time. But here's a shift to personal example. not just talking about and teaching these things, not classroom alone. When thou sittest in thy house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. And this is just the point that I'm making. And here it is in Jesus' Bible already long ago, that knowing the Lord is not a matter of intellectual information only. We surely do need teaching and careful teaching and good doctrine and truth on that level. But, oh, I almost said in Hebrew, oy vavoy lanu, woe are we, if that's where it stays. How far is it from the brain to the heart? What is it, about 20 centimeters? Someone has said those 20 centimeters are the longest distance in the world, from head to heart. And how many of your friends that you know who have some knowledge about Jesus, but the 20 centimeters haven't been traveled into daring to trust him, to step out in obedience, and then check him out and find that it works and grow in knowledge. Now we're going to go from something that was really profound, if we could just live it, to Mickey Mouse. And what I want to do, not for most of you who already have been using a certain coloring scheme to color your synopses, is just briefly to color one text so that those folks watching the video will have a chance to see what we're doing, how a certain color coding kind of very careful, picky, technical work is, we hope, leading us into the character of our synoptic texts. And so if you'll turn to page 115 in your synopsis, we'll just color this now together. We'll color this now together so that the coloring methodology might be clear to everyone. And the trick here is to distinguish between four different relationships. One is when all three Gospels have perfectly identical words. Now we're doing this in English, not in Greek, which are our oldest documents, and not in Hebrew, which Jesus was probably speaking, so we're a couple steps away. But still, it's amazing what you can learn, even these couple steps away. So we're using red, where the words are identical in all three. And when I was marking my synopsis, I finally realized that these interrelationships are sometimes so complicated that I started doing it in pencil first, because when you do it with felt tip, you're stuck. And you do it with green and you found out, I should have done this in yellow. And so I actually have marked this overhead here very gently in pencil ahead of time. And let's start with the lightest color and see what's similar between Mark and Matthew. And here we're going to mark which commandment because those are perfectly identical words in the Matthew column and in the Mark column. Way down here we have the word second. That's the same in both. And you shall love is the same in both. I'm not going to mark them all. I just want to give this brief demonstration of the marking method.
Then let's find with the green color words that are the same in Matthew and in Luke. And here they are agreeing that it's a lawyer, Luke says, who stood up to test Jesus. And Matthew, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. So actually the words to test are also the same in Matthew and in Luke. Now, do we have any words that are the same in Mark and Luke that we mark with orange? And sure enough, all your strength does not appear in Matthew, but here in Luke. And with all your strength, and in Mark, and with all your strength. And then the fourth category we'll mark is where all three have exactly the same wording. And here it's a direct quote from Jesus. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. That's the same in Matthew, in Mark, and in Luke. Your neighbor as yourself in Matthew, in Mark, and in Luke. And there are other relationships in this passage, but I think that gives us an illustration of the marking method where we're able to see at a glance not everything that's similar, but a minimal approach of everything that's perfectly identical, in English at least. And then we see the passages that we didn't mark are where one gospel writer has it and the other two don't. So that was an illustration of this marking method. And some at least Derek White, director of Christian Friends of Israel, who is really responsible for calling us together for this Bible study, has marked the entire synopsis. And I hold him up as an example that I haven't followed myself, because I actually have my Greek synopsis that I've been using in the past with Greek on one page and English on the other, because I'm not a great Greek and Hebrew scholar like my professors David Flusser at the Hebrew University and Dr. Robert Lindsay, who was a Baptist pastor for some 40 years. More about them on another occasion. And so this is new for me as well as for you to be marking this Throckmorton's synopsis. And I confess to a certain method in my madness of choice of colors. The warm colors are where Mark is involved, red and orange and yellow. And green, where Mark isn't involved at all. Wherever you see green, Mark doesn't have those words at all. And the early insight of Dr. Robert Lindsay was passages that we're marking as green were very unusual Greek that translates easily to Hebrew.
And where there's red, they're all three agreeing. Passages that we're marking in red are also generally more Hebraic, because there Mark is agreeing with the other two writers. But where Mark is not agreeing with both of the others, where Mark is writing on his own, or where you have Mark and Matthew, Mark's Greek is a more pure Greek and less reflecting Semitic syntax behind it. And so there's a certain grading, in a very rough way, to this color system, that the darker colors are text that tends to have a more Hebraic background, and the lighter colors have been written in a more flowing Greek. More about that later. This is just our first introduction to the color coding. Now, we're about to conclude this first hour. We have about 5 minutes to go. And I'm sure that any one of you who have started this assignment, whether you've been able to finish or not, have had some questions come up from this marking. And what I'm curious about is just some of your first reactions, because, well, I don't want to say much, you know, put words in your mouth. I'm more curious just to hear, you know, what has been your emotional reaction? What has been your intellectual reaction as you have noted these fantastic similarities and these peculiar differences? And let me just leave it at that. Let me just see if a few of you wouldn't be willing to give some reaction, and I not put any words in your mouth, you know, as to, I'll only do something as vague as this, as, you know, did you like what you were finding out? I mean, did you kind of enjoy it? Did you get a kick out of it? Was it exciting? I mean, did you have positive reactions, or did you have negative reactions to what you were finding out as you were marking the text? Is there anybody who's kind of has such a kind of an immediate reaction that you'd be ready to share it with us? The green seems to be predominant. Is there anyone else who noticed that about the green coloring? In other words, finding identical wording between Matthew and Luke. This is, in fact, the first thing that struck Dr. Lindsay's attention. And when we talk about the origins of the Jerusalem school, we're going to be talking about Dr. Lindsay, that sometimes whole paragraphs almost, you can color solid green. Because Matthew and Luke know how to agree on the wording of the story that they're telling. Are there any other reactions? I mean, did you expect to find more of this? You know, more common wording? As you were marking, did it come out approximately, you know, what you suspected anyway? Because you've perhaps been reading the different accounts and you've noticed the differences?
Then the red. That's the next most strong, obvious color.
Well, and you're not meaning now in terms of just the strength of the color, but the amount.
The amount. I'm looking at the amount.
The red color. That the amount of text where all three have identical wording. We're going to be looking at this quite carefully. And so what we're doing is just checking some first early reactions. We're going to, I mean, I did really Mickey Mouse work for my doctoral thesis. I mean, I can tell you that Matthew's text, you know, that you've colored green because there are identical, 50% of Matthew's text, if he's telling the same story as Luke, will be green on an average. I mean, sometimes it's lower, sometimes it's as much as 90%. But it averages out, if you take all of the Matthean Lucan stories that nobody else has, Matthew's text will have 50% verbal identity with the Lucan version of the same story. Now, when you get to the red marking, that verbal identity drops down quite a lot. In fact, if you look at the three Gospels, because red marking means they all three have exactly the same word, there's only 16% of the words that are perfectly identical in all three Gospels when they're telling the same story. And so this is the kind of thing that we're going to turn to. I wanted to start with basics, Jesus. And then we're going to turn to some really peculiar problems as we start now reflecting together on who are these disciples anyway, and how did God dare to use such differing personalities through whom to reflect that one gospel, that one witness to the Lord Jesus. So with that, we'll conclude our first session.